Welcome to part 5 of our guide to painting the Warhammer Age of Sigmar box set. In this part, we're going to be concentrating on the Blood Warriors, who are the Berserkers of the Gortide. I'm going to be using the Chaos Champion miniature to show you how to paint them, because this will cover everything you need to know. So things like the armour, the brass, and the bone, and all the chainmail as well. Now, at the same time, I'm also going to be painting the Blood Secretor, because he's painted in mostly the same way, but there are a few unique details on him, and as we encounter them, we'll switch to that model to show you how to paint them. So, let's get to it. Whenever I'm painting a miniature with a lot of elaborate trim work on, like lots of Chaos models have, I find it's easiest to start by painting that trim work, because you can be quite messy with it and it doesn't matter because you'll neaten up as you add further colours. Now for our Blood Warrior, the first colour that we need for this trim is going to be Balthazar Gold. So as always, make sure the lid's fully closed and you give the paint a good shake before you use each one. Now because I'm going to be putting quite a lot of this on, I'm going to start by using my large beige brush. So all you've got to do is use it to pick up a lot of paint off the pot and put it onto a palette. So having the palette means you can control how much paint's on your brush, which is really useful. Also, it means you can thin the paint down with a little bit of water so that it'll go a bit further. So I'm going to use the palette now to make sure I don't have too much paint on here, because I don't want to apply too much in one go, because if I do, I can start clogging up detail. And once you're ready, all you've got to do is start painting this onto your miniature, onto all the areas that you want to be this brass colour. So I'm generally looking at all the trim, but there's also a few decorative elements as well, such as the little icons we've got down here. Now when you're painting this on, I do recommend you apply two thin coats of it. Resist putting on one thick coat, because doing so can start to clog detail. Multiple thin coats, on the other hand, keep the detail nice and sharp. I've finished base coating the Balthazar Gold on both models now, and you can see I've really not been very neat. I've just made sure I've painted all the parts that I want to be brass with the brass base colour. Now, a quick tip for you, I recommend at this point you change your water. That's because metallic paints contain small little flecks of metal in them. Now, when using small amounts of metallic paints, this isn't a problem, but when you use quite a lot, like we've just done, it does contaminate your water. This can even contaminate your other colours when you're using the water to thin them down. So, I do recommend you clean your water at this point. Now, the next colour we're going to be using is Corn Red, and for this, I'm going to be applying it using my small base brush. This is because I need to be in much more control of what I'm doing this time, so I'm still going to use the palette to thin it down with a little bit of water, but also I'm going to use the palette to control how much paint's on the brush, and I'm going to do that by just dragging my brush along and twisting it to bring the bristles to a nice tip, and this will give me the most control that I can get. And what I'm going to do really is start colouring in the armour with all the parts I want to be red. So generally these are the flatter parts in between all the trim. I just need to be as neat as you can with this stage because you do need to fill in all of these parts, and also I recommend you apply two thin coats to get the red to be nice and strong. You can see applying Corn Red's made a really big difference to the miniatures, and what we're going to do now is carry on with the next base colour, which is Lead Belcher, and this is going to be for all the silver parts on the models. Now I'm still going to be using my small base brush to apply this, and like with the Corn Red, I'm going to use the palette to control how the paint's going to be applied. So add a little bit of water into that mix there, then use the palette to make sure that I've got a nice tip on the brush as well. There, about that's right. Then just twist the brush along like that. Bring the bristles to a nice tip, and then really all you need to do is start picking out all the parts that you want to be silver. So generally what I'm going to be looking for are things like the chainmail, which you can see hanging here. This appears all over these miniatures. Also, I'm going to be painting the blades on weapons, and I just want to point out on this particular guy, the axe blade in the front is made of bone, but there is the back, which I'm going to be base coating with Lead Belcher as well. And also, there's a couple of random spikes sticking around the model, which are going to be silver too. If you're not sure which bits to do, then I just suggest you look at the box art, and that'll give you some great ideas of which parts to pick out. I finished applying the Lead Belcher now, and I just want to quickly point out that I did apply two coats in the end to make sure the colour was nice and strong. And now I just got a few more base colours to apply before we add some shade to the miniatures. Now the first of these is going to be Abaddon Black. This is for the weapon grips, the boots, the gloves, also hair, and on the Blood Secretor there's his trousers as well. After that I'm going to be using Mournfang Brown to paint all the leather straps. These crisscross the body and also around the belts too. And then finally we're going to be using Xandri Dust to paint all of the bone parts all over the miniatures. So I'm going to still be using my small base brush for all of these. Starting out with Abaddon Black, I'm just going to get the paint ready in exactly the same way we have been doing, by adding a little bit of water in there to thin it down. Then all you've got to do is start base coating this onto the areas you want to be black. So on our model here, I'm going to start by applying it onto his boots. And again, just remember to be as neat as you can whenever you're getting close to the completed colours. The next base colour to use is Mournfang Brown, and this is for all the leather straps. Also, just keep an eye out on your model in case there's any fur, and if there is, base coat it with this colour as well. And I do recommend applying two thin coats of this colour. And the final base colour before the shade is Zandri Dust, and this is for all the bone parts on the miniatures. Now I've switched over to the Blood Secretor to show you this because there's just so much bone, especially on this icon here, and I just thought I'd show you how to apply it here. There's no great trick to it, you just need to be neat whenever you're getting close to other colours, but other than that, just base coat the entirety of the bone areas. And I do recommend two thin coats to get a nice solid colour. With the Zandri Dust now applied, we've finished putting on all the base colours that use the same shade. So what we're going to do now is apply that shade, and the one in question is Agrax Earthshade. Now I'm going to be using my medium shade brush to apply this, so I can put on plenty at once. So you just need to get a good amount loaded on your brush, and use your palette as usual to control how much we've got. You want plenty on your brush, and all you've got to do is start painting this all over your miniatures. Now you need to make sure that you really do work it into all the little details as you apply it, so really poke it around so you get it everywhere. And also make sure you apply plenty, but not so much that it's all dripping off the model and pooling towards the bottom, because if it does do that, it can leave a few horrible marks towards the bottom of the miniature. Also remember to give it plenty of time to dry, and about 40 minutes will be fine. The shade's now fully dry, and you can see it's given loads of depth to the miniatures, but it has also dulled them down as well. Now we will be brightening them up and highlighting them as well, but before we start doing that, I'm going to begin painting the flesh. And we're going to go for the same sort of colour scheme that we went for on the Blood Reavers, so a really pale skin tone. This is going to be a great way of uniting the whole force together. Now there is some skin visible on the Blood Warriors, but there's much more visible on the Blood Secretor, so I'm going to show you how to do it on him, but the technique is exactly the same for all of these miniatures. And the first colour that you need is Rakarth Flesh. Now I'm going to apply this using my small base brush once again, and I'm going to be using my palette again to make sure that I can thin the paint down and control how much is on the brush. So a little bit of water mixed in there, then use the palette just to get rid of the excess paint and bring the bristles together nicely. And then all we need to do is start base coating the skin with this colour. So I'm going to start up here on the face, I'm just going to start painting this on, and be aware you will need to apply two thin coats of this colour to get a nice even coverage. But remember to keep those two coats nice and thin so you keep the detail really sharp. Once you finish the base coat of Rakarth Flesh, the next thing to do is to layer over the skin. Now the colour for this is going to be Flayed One Flesh. I'm going to apply this using my medium layer brush. Now having the Rakarth Flesh down first of all means this colour is going to be nice and strong. So we need to just get it ready in the same kind of way as before by thinning it down with a little bit of water, and then just start layering this over completely over all the areas that you've just done with Rakarth Flesh. Except for a small part on this model here, because you can actually see part of his skull just there, and I'm going to avoid that. But everywhere else is going to get a layer of Flayed One Flesh. And I do recommend, once again, two thin coats of this colour. Once you've finished applying the layer of Flayed One Flesh, the next thing to do is to put a shade over the skin. Now I'm going to be using Reichlin Flesh Shade for this, and I'm going to be applying it using my medium layer brush. And that's because the shade brush is a bit too big for the amount I want to put on here, and having a smaller brush will just give me a bit more control over how much I apply. So you just need to get some ready on your brush and just start painting this over the skin. I'm going to start once again on the head up here. I'm just going to make sure it settles nicely in all the recesses, but that I don't put on so much that I lose control of it, because I don't want this on any of the other colours that we've done so far. Now that the Reichlin Flesh Shade is fully dry, we can start a process of brightening up some of the colours once again. Now, first of all, we're going to be using Corn Red for all of the armour. Then after that, we're going to be going back to Flayed One Flesh for painting on the skin. I'm going to be starting with the Corn Red using my medium layer brush, and if you want, you can use a small layer brush for this stage. It really depends on what you're comfortable with. But what really matters is getting the fine tip on your brush. Okay, so remember, once again, to water your paints down, and to just twist your brush to bring the bristles to a nice tip. And what you're looking to do here is reapply this over the red armour that we did earlier, but this time, not doing all of it. So if I start on this panel here, what I'm going to do is generally paint the middle of it, and when I get to the edges where the shade is settled between the red and the brass, I'm just going to leave that, and we get that nice depth that just distinguishes the two different colours. So like that. Now also, when you have areas where there is no brass trim, you're just looking for any recessed bits where the shade is settled. For example, down there, I'm just going to avoid that bit where the shade is and just paint on either side like that. So you just need to do this now on all the red panels. And then repeat this process on the skin using Flayed One Flesh with your small layer brush. Now once again, you're looking to paint most of it, just leaving the shade still showing in the areas where it's settled. So for example, we've got in the recess of the eye there, and just underneath the nose too. And this is true for all over the skin, so that includes things like the fingers, where you want to paint the actual raised part of the fingers, just leaving the shade in those little recesses in between. With those colours now brightened up, we can start highlighting the miniatures. And the first area I'm going to highlight are all the metallic parts, so both the brass and the silver. And to do these, I'm going to be using the same colour, which is Runefang Steel. And a technique I'm going to use here is called edge highlighting. And to do this, I recommend you get a small layer brush, and it's very important you make sure the paint's flowing smoothly. So you must add a bit of water to it, just to thin it down like that. And then make sure you've got that really good tip in your brush. The finer a tip you can get, the better, because what you're looking to do essentially is paint lines following the edges of all of the metallic parts. So I'm going to start on these parts, and in some cases it's actually quite easy because you can use the edge of the armour. If I angle my brush like that, so I'm just catching the edge and just paint along it, I get a bright silver line very quickly and very neatly, like that, you see? Now in other cases you will have to keep your hands as steady as possible and follow the actual edge of the metallic, such as round here, for example. Now, when you're doing this part, if you do make any mistakes on the side where the little recess is, you can paint a little bit of Agrax Earthshade back in there to neaten that up. Just really take your time with this stage because it is the longest stage, but the effect of it is, well, really strong and looks really good. So take your time with it. To paint the chainmail, just make sure you've got a little bit less Runefang Steel on your brush, and all you need to do is lightly run it down some of the links, just like that, just to pick out some of them and bring out some of the details of the chainmail. I've finished highlighting with the metallics now, and you can see just what a difference that Runefang Steel has made. All the features are really popping out now, and what we need to do now is, well, carry on highlighting some other colours to really make them stand out in the same kind of way. So the first one I'm going to do is to highlight all the red parts using Evil Sun Scarlet, so once again on all the edges. After that, we're going to be using Pallid Witch Flesh to highlight all the skin. Then we'll be using Eshin Grey to highlight all the black parts, like the boots, for example. And then finally, we'll be using Scrag Brown to highlight all the brown leather straps. So starting out with Evil Sun Scarlet, using the small layer brush once again. Again, like I say, the technique is exactly the same as what we just did with the silver. So I'm going to thin my paint down with a bit of water so it's flowing easily, then use a palette to make sure I've got a nice fine tip on my brush, and then what you're looking to do is to paint this on all the sharper edges on the red. So for example, they've got this quite sharp angle here in the middle of this plate, so all I'm going to do is paint a bit of red, just following that line down in the centre, like that. And the same is true on all of these panels, so such as around the knee, for example, where I've got all these sharp edges, like around here. The next colour is Pallid Witch Flesh to highlight all the skin. Now I'm going to use a Blood Secretor for this because there's so much more skin visible on this model. And what you're looking to do is just paint some lines following all the sharpest features. So for example on the face, I'm looking down the centre of the nose, the eyebrows along here, just underneath the eye there, following the cheekbone. So it's all features like this just to bring out the details of the face. On the hands, however, what you're looking to do is just paint along the fingers, just a thin line just running down the middle of them, just to bring out the shape of the hand. The next area to highlight are all the black parts using Eshin Grey. Now for this, the technique is exactly the same, just follow any sharper edges on these details. And you're looking at things like the boots, and also the weapon grips, and also the hair, if your model has any. And finally, highlight all the brown leather straps using Scrag Brown. And once again, it's the same method of just painting a thin line along each of the edges. With those highlights applied, there's just one more major feature on each of the models to do before we move on to the final details, and that is, of course, to paint the bone. Now for this, the first colour you need is a Shabti bone. I'm going to apply it using the small layer brush once again, because I want as much control as possible. So I'm going to make use of the palette for sure, and I'm going to thin the paint down once again with a bit of water so it's flowing easily, and that's very important for this stage. So use a palette to control how much paint's on your brush. You don't need too much, and you want it to be a little bit transparent like I'm getting here. And all you need to do, I'll start on this guy because there's so much bone on here, I'll start on this icon here. What you're looking to do is to paint most of it, just leaving the areas where the shade is settled. So if I start on this ridge here, I'm just going to paint around there neatly, avoiding that bit of shade just settled just there. And same is true up around there. And I've got a little bit sort of settled around the edge just there. So I'm going to avoid it and paint in the middle there. Go close to the next ridge. And you see in doing this, I'm just filling out that whole section, really bringing out the features of it. And all you've got to do is repeat this on, well, on each of them, really. Now for the skulls, it's much the same process. You just need to make sure you get your paint ready once again so it's flowing easily. And what I tend to do with this is start by painting the forehead. So just a little line along there. And once again, I'm going to avoid all the areas where the shade is settled more. So the eye sockets are a definite for that. And also the nose as well. So just paint around there. And underneath it too. And then for the teeth, you just need to paint some lines on them just to pick those details out. There we go. And then for the forehead, you just paint most of it, just leaving any little runes that are etched in where the shade is settled once again. and just go down close to where the ridge is, like that. Now, the final large area of bone on this model is to paint the spine. So for this, again, get the paint ready. And well, what I do for this is start by painting these little central ridges that run down the middle. So you just need to pick those out, running all the way down. And the same is true on these ones on the ends. So you just pick those out as well. Then in between them, just lightly run your brush down center there, just let it pick out the raised parts of the details, like that. And you just need to do that all the way down the spine. I finished applying the layer of a shabty bone now, and I'm going to apply a second coat of it, because if I apply a second coat on the flatter areas, such as on the top of the skull here, you can see the colour's much stronger the second time round. And this is a great way of starting to build up the highlights for the bone. So you just need to look for any flatter areas like that and just start picking them out with a nice smooth coat of it. So the same is true on these bones here. Just look for the flatter parts and just apply a second coat over it. Now that we've finished the layering, there's just one more step to go to finish the bone, and that is to do a highlight using Pallid Witch Flesh. Now, once again, I'm going to be using my small layer brush for this, and this is going to be much like the highlights we were doing earlier when we were highlighting the red and the metallics. You need to make sure you thin your paint down with some water so that it's flowing nice and easily, and then make sure you've got a nice tip on your brush by using the palette to bring the bristles together. And what you're looking to do here is to paint this along all the sharpest edges. Now, in a lot of cases, this is quite obvious. For example, on the bones on here, you're just looking for these edges where each layer of bone goes over the other, and you just follow it around the edge like that, just to pick out that detail. So you see it's nice and straightforward like that. Now, when it comes to skulls, on the other hand, there's a few features that you really should pick out to make the face and the skull nice and strong. So those things, what I go for are things like the brow. So I'll start by painting a line just running along the brow ridge like that. And then a little bit on the cheekbones, just down there and down there. Top of the nose. And then I usually put a little bit on the teeth as well, just to start picking those bits out. So just a small amount, just running along the teeth there. And then just there's some lines going up from the edge of the eye socket, just there, up towards the top of the skull. Like that. So you just need to carry on doing this now on all of the bone. And with the bone completed, we've now finished the blood secretor, except for his base, of course. But on the blood warrior, there's just a few final details left to do. I'm going to do those now. So the first colour we're going to need for this is Screamer Pink, and this is to paint the flesh of the mouth that's erupting out of his belly. After that, we're going to shade that mouth using Reichland Flesh Shade, and then finally add a highlight to it using Evil Sun Scarlet. And then the last detail to paint on him is his eyes, and for this you just need Flash Gits Yellow. But I'm going to be starting out with Screamer Pink for painting his belly, and for this I'm using my small layer brush once again, and I'm going to be getting the paint ready in exactly the same way as we have been doing. So mix a little bit of water in there so it's nice and thin, and then make sure there's not too much on your brush, and all you've got to do is start painting this on the area. Now just be careful as you're painting this, because you do have to kind of, well, work inside the model almost. Just be really careful of that brass trim around the mouth. Next, shade the inside of the mouth using Reichland Flesh Shade, and again, just be careful as you're doing this so you don't get it on the trim. Next, use Evil Sun Scarlet to highlight some of the details in the mouth. Now, all I'm going to look to do here is to pick out the tonsil there, which is a small amount of the red, and also just this edge running around where would be the throat, really, I suppose, just around there like that, just to pick out these details so you can see them clearly from a distance. And finally, using your small layer brush, paint a small amount of Flash Gits Yellow just in the eye. And all you've got to do is touch your brush to the surface of the eyeball, just like that, to pick it out. And once you've done this, all that remains to do is to base your models. And as always, I recommend you base them in the same way as the rest of your army. Now that the eyes are painted and the base finished, the Blood Warrior is complete, and so is the Blood Secretor. And you now have all the information that you need to paint the entire unit of Blood Warriors. And these guys are going to really stand out as the elite of the Gortide, in particular because of the nice strong highlights we've got and all that brass trim. So remember, whenever you're painting models that have elaborate trim work on their armour, like how these guys do, a really great way to paint that is by painting the trim first, because you can be quite messy with it, and then really it's a simple case of neatening up by filling in the main colour in between, in this case with corn red. Now, you can do it the other way around if you want to, by painting the corn red first and then doing the trim, but doing it that way is more complex and will take longer. Now, when you're applying shade to your miniatures, always remember to put on plenty so that it's settling nicely in the recesses, but not so much that it's pooling towards the bottom of the model. So just keep an eye on it to make sure it's not doing that. And then after that's dry and you're putting the layer paints on, remember to apply each layer thinly, because that way you can apply multiple coats and gradually build up a colour, which can give a really nice effect, in particular on the bone. And finally, always remember to practice being as neat as you possibly can. So really practice keeping your hands steady, because the neater you are, the better the final result's going to be. So now we've painted the vast majority of the troops in the Gortide, and we're going to move on to the biggest model in it, the Khorgarath. So I'll see you in the next part, where we're going to paint that monster.